It's hard to say exactly why Matt Garstka's video, Kepler, on the Mino YouTube channel is so captivating, but it's sure to go down as a drum nerd classic. In fact, if you haven't seen it yet, just click the link below and watch it now. Then come back here and I'll tell you more. Yes, I did just tell people to click away from my video. Yes, I realize that's YouTube suicide. And I'm doing it anyway, because Kepler is that awesome. Still here? Back? Great. Just click the subscribe button. Nah, you know I don't do that. While it's hard to say exactly why this video sticks in our minds so much, it's undeniably catchy. You want to tap your foot to it. You can't help tapping on the steering wheel if you're driving, or on the back of your phone or laptop. But, popular as it is, there are a few little details you may not have picked up about Kepler, and they may help explain how it became such an earworm. And heck, they may also help your drumming. In this video, I'm going to be breaking down 5 details you may not have noticed about Matt Garstka's Kepler video, which are nonetheless awesome. Stay tuned. Detail 1. Common denominators over triple meter. Check out this clip really quick. Hear how he plays the ride cymbal bell on the downbeats of bar 1, and then it seems to shift in bar 2? This is a common denominator. I'm not sure anybody else calls it that, but I'm making it up. But check it. The simplest example is a meter like 7/8, where the pulse would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, but you clap on quarter notes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1. As you can see, it takes 2 bars of 7/8 to cycle back around so the quarter notes fall on the 1. One famous example of this from the Vinnie Cauda canon is Sting's song St. Augustine in Hell from the album 10 Summoner's Tales. If somebody up there likes me, if somebody up there cares to live on me from evil, to save me from this wicked snare. Anyway, this part of Kepler is in triple meter. It's in 11, but they're feeling it as a bar of 6 and a bar of 5. And if we call that 11/8, then what Matt's implying is dotted quarters over the top. But 3 doesn't divide evenly into 11, so the dotted quarters aren't going to resolve at the end of the bar. In fact, it'll take 3 bars, 33/8, that's 3 times 11, for the dotted quarters to land on the downbeat again after 11 dotted quarters. In practice, it sounds like the dotted quarter is on the downbeat for bar 1, on the second triplet for bar 2, and on the last triplet for bar 3, before it lands on the downbeat again at the beginning of the fourth bar. Here's Matt playing the section again. And here's the implied common denominator. Got it? But common denominators can also exist in duple and quadruple time, as our second example illustrates. Oh, super quick, why should we care? This is math music, right? Everybody wants to know how to do cool fills and then glazes over as soon as we start talking about math. Here's the thing though. You don't have to play math music to appreciate it. And plenty of this stuff will make your playing sound better in 4, because you'll have more interesting phrases in your head. And your time and groove will also be better because you've practiced holding a rhythm down in an unfamiliar context. So you've shocked your system out of complacency. But also, maybe embrace the math a little. If we want to get better, we shouldn't want it to be easier, to paraphrase John F. Kennedy in CrossFit. We should want to be stronger. Okay, public service message over. On to number 2. Detail 2. Common denominators over quadruple meter. Sounds a little boring and esoteric, right? But here's what it sounds like. Hear how it's off-kilter and shifting underneath like an odd meter, but it doesn't have that three-legged dog feeling. Instead, it just rocks, vaguely like Rush. That's why common denominators are awesome. You hear a lot of them in Tigran Hamasyan's music, like in this clip. Everybody who's familiar with this video knows that Matt is 16thizing, kind of like Vijay Iyer does. So it'll be an 11 with the triplet sounding bass for sections like this. Then it'll turn into basically 15-16 with the equivalent resolution points and bar length in spots like this. Matt's doing that by 16thizing the meter. If that sounds abstract, an easy example to grasp would be if you're playing a shuffle in 4, then you started playing 16th notes instead of triplets. In Kepler, if you do the same thing by double timing or 16thizing the triplet bass, you turn 11 into 15 without increasing the ground tempo. Makes sense? This isn't even the thing yet, by the way. So this feels odd metery and angular, right? But what if you need something you can bang your head to and hopefully avoid CTE? Like this. Well, for that, you need a common denominator. Very quick math lesson. If you want to play quarter notes on the ride cymbal bell over 15-16, and you want to know how many bars of 15 it's going to take to cycle around, you need a common multiple of 4 and 15, because each quarter note is 4 sixteenths. That's going to be 60 sixteenths. 4 cycles of 15, 15 cycles of 4. So your bell quarters are going to cycle every 4 bars of 15 so that they're on the downbeat again. Maybe a more common sense way to illustrate this is 15-16 is like a bar of 4 that's missing the last 16th. You know how you have windshield wipers that sometimes get out of phase? Say you've got one windshield wiper that takes the entire length of a bar of 4, and the other that takes just one 16th note short of that. In more common parlance, that means in the first bar, the quarter is going to be on the downbeat. In the second bar, the meter outruns the quarter by 1/16. So the quarter will be on what sounds like the second 16th of the beat. In the third bar, the meter outruns the quarter by yet another 16th. So the quarter will sound like it's on the eighth offbeat or the third 16th. Finally, in the fourth bar, we lose yet another 16th relative to the time signature. So our quarter is going to sound like it's on the last 16th. Now for the composite. Here's Matt playing the section again. Detail 3, dotted eighths over 15-16. This is one of the coolest effects. Here's the normal 15-16 from earlier in the tune. But here's what happens when they superimpose dotted eighths over it. If you play dotted eighths over a bar of 4, you get this effect. It takes you 3 bars to come back around to beat 1, because dotted eighths are the equivalent to 3/16. So you need a common multiple of 3 and 4, which is 12 beats, or 3 bars of 4. But Kepler's bridge is in 15, felt as a bar of 4 missing a 16th, like this. So if we play dotted eighths over it, 3/16 divide into 15/16, and we just get a bar of 5. To demonstrate, I'll play one bar of 15 as a bar of 4 missing a 16th, and another bar that's 5 groups of 3. Here's Here's the transition in the real recording when Matt and guitarist Josh De La Victoria transition from one way of feeling that meter to the other. Keep this in your head because in the outro coda, it gets better. Detail 4. Quintuplets over dotted eighths. Here's where stuff gets really wonky. A bar of 15 is 5 groups of 3, but it's also 3 groups of 5. But what happens if you do both at once? In the outro to Kepler, Matt and Josh maintain the dotted eighth feel of the 15-16, but play a counter figure against it that's 5/16 long. This is classic counter rhythm from my What Makes Hard Tunes Hard lesson, and it's also textbook Tigran. Let's check it out. We'll hear the triplet bass for the 15 first, then they'll transition into the coda, and you'll hear that 5-beat counter rhythm. And this is what we call jazz face. If this clip makes you want to die, in a good way, because it's so killing, you might be a jazz musician. So we've got 15-16 felt as 5 with a triplet bass here. But you can also feel it as 3 groups of 5, like this. Now I'll keep the 5 groups of 3 on the stack and imply the 3 groups of 5 with the rest of the beat. Better yet, let's hear the masters play it again. Not to mention, you've got what sounds like a double triad based on the second scale degree of the scale of which the pedal note is the root. I'll leave that sort of thing to guys like Rick Beato and Adam Neely. But it's also extra sick. Much jazz face enhancing. And detail 5. 5 modulates into 3 by old quintuplet bass become new triplet bass. Did that sound Russian? It feels like something Spetsnaz would be into. Animals as leaders, drummer, make great pride for Russian nation. Anyway, here's how that modulation sounds. Let me show you. So, if you remember where we left off, 15-16 felt as 5 groups of 3. Became 15-16 felt as 3 groups of 5. By that point, it was already basically in 3. The last shift is from a quintuplet bass in 3 to a triplet bass in 3. Here's Matt and Josh doing it again. That completes the transition into 3 for the solo, guitar solo trading thing. I let that one run a little long because it's awesome. So dudes, if you've enjoyed this lesson, here's what you can do next. Because I've used a bunch of Minos content here, to stay within the bounds of fair use, this needs to be non-commercial. But I believe the powers that be will allow me to offer you something for free. Click below play to get 3 videos in 3 weeks, make your playing lots better. Seriously guys, just click the link below the player, enter your email address in on the next page. You'll get 3 free videos that'll make your playing better in the next 3 weeks than it's gotten in the last 6 months. Dudes, it's been real. Enjoy this one a lot. See you soon. How's my hair look weird? Comrade Solzhenitsyn-Rite, Gulag Archipelago. I think it's all drums from here on down. You're not Tom York! I actually need to reshoot that whole thing. Jesus Christ. Comrade Solzhenitsyn-Rite. What accent is that? Oh wait, I'm supposed to improvise something.